Thursday morning, is it? Kilometre 1375. Just been chased off by a pack of wild dogs from the night fox creek we were looking forward to having smoking.
The Desert Riders project was an extreme off-road tour of the Central Sahara that would test the limits of what was possible on a motorcycle. Our ambitious 7,000-kilometre itinerary would lead us across the summits and along the canyons winding through the Tassili Najer Plateau. From there, we head south to the featureless plains of the Tenere Desert and the bandit lands of northeastern Niger. If things look good, we'd head southeast to the Ayer Mountains and Agadez before returning north to Algeria, Tamanrasset and the Hoggar Mountains. But first we needed three machines for the job. KTMs were the obvious choice, but we settled for the less radical Honda XR650L and imported three from Western Australia. The XRL features a proven Dominator engine in a well-suspended XR chassis. Out of the crate, an XRL runs like a dog and is not exactly an off-the-shelf overlander like a KTM, but we could fix that, while the vital reliability and fuel economy could hopefully be taken for granted. Once we had the bike set up, it was time to pay a visit to Overland Solutions in Kent for the all-important fabrication work. Our huge 40-litre tanks would need more than rubber bungs to hold them in place, while the skimpy XR subframe needed substantial bracing and a sturdy rack to support our alloy boxes. As the departure date neared, we undertook the final preparations to make our machines into functional long-range desert tourers. I listed all these modifications on the Desert Riders website, which also outlined our planned route and details of our satellite telephone calls, or satchats, which we'd ring in from the desert every week or so. They're featured on this film. We even took a finished bike up the London South Bank for a photo call, made ourselves feel stupid, and then sent off a stack of press releases to alert the world's media to this historic event. The Desert Riders Manifesto included a directive to range across uncharted desert for up to a week at a time. So, a couple of months before we set off, I went out there with my Land Cruiser and a dozen jerrycans to organise four key fuel and food dumps. I left two jerrys and a day's food at the Wetsamin dune crossing. 110 litres of fuel and 4 days' food and water were buried at Erkilien to get us across the Tenere Desert. There'd be another crate of food and an oil change waiting for us at Tamanrasset. And another 6 jerrys of fuel stashed on a rocky hill east of the Amgid crater so we could take the long way home. But Erkilien was the key dump, and like all the dumps, was positioned just before our fuel PNR, or point of no return. This way, should any of the vital dumps be missing or unlocatable, we'd have enough to ride back from where we come from, pouring all the fuel into one bike if necessary. And with war in Iraq looming, these needed to be GPS-proof locations, able to be recognised by memory and landmarks alone, should the GPS signal be degraded. There you go, you'd hardly notice I've been there at all. With a GPS point for backup, everything was now in place. And so, in mid-January, we set off for our big Sahara adventure. Being desert riders, we van the bikes to Genoa in northern Italy and jumped on the ferry just as they were hauling up the ramp. Next stop, Tunis, on the coast of North Africa. Once here, we filled out the endless forms and set off south across Tunisia. In Tunisia, a blood-stained sheepskin hanging by the roadside means fresh mutton is on the menu. We pulled in for a feed and a rest, but later wished we were sitting on those comfy sheepskins for the last few hundred clicks to Nefta.
That was the first day on the red shed.
Oh, on my ass. It was a beauty.
Really?
Yeah, you get the combination of speed wobble and bends in the
Mr. Bell, your impressions of the red shed off the first big day?
It was rather like riding a neoprene banana for 500 kilometres. I think it was absolutely miserable.
I've got to say, I'm worried how these things are going to handle on the dirt, you know.
I think so, yeah.
I think they're going to really wobble uncontrollably.
We're doomed.
I mean,
yep, at the end of day one, we weren't that impressed with our heavy-laden Hondas. Still, it was to be our last hotel for weeks, and so we made the most of it over a game of pool. After dinner, we discussed our reservations about the bikes.
No, well, we arrived now at Nefta.
Indeed.
We've had a day on the bikes.
500 kilometres away.
Yeah. We're wondering whether they're going to be any good in the dirt at all.
And we secretly think they're going to be crap.
Yeah. John here is quite positive, but he's never actually driven in the desert before with a baggage bike. Andy and I have done trips like that before. And we think they're too heavy.
Yes.
They've got enough power.
No.
And they're actually quite dangerous.
Yes. They've got no bottom end. No top end.
No.
No.
They've got plenty of hinge end. Not to be positive. Yes, John. Give us a positive side.
We're here.
Well, tomorrow another 300 or 400 km of the road in Algeria. And the day after, a moment of truth.
Anyway, there was no turning back now, so we pushed on towards the Algerian frontier and took the highway south, through the oil fields and deep into the Algerian Sahara. A couple of days later, we pulled off the road into some dunes to fit some fresh knobblies and bury our road tyres for the ride back.
Just got to change our tyres, eh?
Now the moment of truth, so by tonight we'll know whether they're right within dunes or not.
Ha ha ha! Well, despite some early adjustment to riding styles, we soon got the hang of the XRLs, which proved to be surprisingly adequate in the dunes and nimble on the rocks. We headed south now, riding cross-country with no tracks except our own. Up ahead was our first challenge, the Wed Semen Canyon, an 80-kilometre chasm cutting through the Tassili Niger Plateau. On the way, we pulled out a couple of jerry cans I'd left in a tree to boost our range on the unknown terrain ahead. And we stopped in at the village of Tenere to take on some water. Moved on and camped just short of the canyon's north rim. So we're on our first new track now, the Wed Semen Canyon. We travelled for about half a day behind this kind of barrier of dunes. Spent the night here. It's a bit of a windy night last night, but we were so tired we probably crashed out anyway. Now it's a lovely calm morning, and we're just heading over there to what we think is the north rim of the Wed Semen Canyon. But even getting just over there proved hard enough. So we just left camp half a kilometre ago. We all got stuck a couple of times. Had to pick the bikes up, so in just 5 minutes from starting the day we were worn out. We decided to walk to the pass here and see what the terrain's like, if we can make it there. Our plan was to descend the north rim of the canyon if possible and follow it southeast upstream to its watershed on the escarpment. Crossing this watershed would be the crux, as the map suggested a small cliff just below the crest. But we'd face that problem if we ever got that far.
We're approaching the north rim of the canyon now, and it looks quite a steep drop into there. There's no way we can get into it from here.
Sure enough, the north rim was too steep to ride down at this point. We wrecked further upstream, but things didn't look any easier. But while walking back, we noticed a sandy breach in the north rim. Perhaps we could get the bikes down there. We walked over to have a closer look.
But we can get to it across the rocks here. It'll take a while, it'll be quite tiring, but we could slither down to the bottom of the canyon and at least do a bit of exploring further up to see what there is.
But even getting to this point was easier said than done. Even steering the heavy XRLs up the rocky hillside took us an hour and a lot of sweat. By lunchtime, we finally got all three bikes to the top of the sand slope. And so we began our laborious descent, manhandling the bikes down into the bed of the canyon. Riding was out of the question, as it was impossible to judge the angle of the slope until we were actually sliding down it.
We're always pushing the bikes down. It's taken us a morning, about 4 hours, to cover about 2 kilometres. Of course, we went on foot up there to recce, see we couldn't get down there. Came down here to recce the sand slope. We've got two bikes down. I'm just waiting for John and Andy to bring my bike down. It's a bit easier with two people muscling the bike down. We're not riding down, of course, we're just slithering down the slope.
Desert riders calling in for our second check here on the Wed Semen Canyon, kilometre 1742, position 26:15, 7:24. We've struggled down to the bottom of the canyon. This morning has been a lot of hard work, pretty much what we expected.
Exhausted, having got down to the bottom of the canyon. That wasn't the end of the hard stuff. Just getting out across the bank of the creek at the bottom was hard, rounded stones like I'm walking on now, and then very powdery alluvial stuff that you get stuck in. And so, after our exhausting muscling the bikes down that sand slope, we're even more tired now, having fallen off a couple of times. I had to literally drive the bike through a tree. I couldn't steer it. I just had to keep going to keep the thing moving. Smashed us through this tree. Bent my gear lever back, but kept the thing moving, which is all that counts in that situation. And now we found this abandoned village back there, where we're going to spend the rest of the day. We're not driving another meter today. We're going to rest up, get our energy back, and then tomorrow we're not going to bother with getting further up the canyon. We're going to head back downstream, as it were, and then back north to the dune crossing we did yesterday, and along the regular piece to Ilitsi. We're already discovering, I think, the limitations of desert biking, which is probably why the whole world doesn't do it for their holidays. That is the fact that there may be more versatile off-road than a car in some situations, but the payload you've got to carry just to survive for a couple of days in the desert makes them very dangerous to drive. It's not an exaggeration to say that. They really are dangerous. You get tired, you fall off. The more you fall off, the more you get tired, to the point where you can't keep the bike up anymore. And that's what we found today. We're just at the end of our tether, having driven no less than 3 kilometres from our camp this morning. It's taken us half a day.
And so, after an afternoon of recovery and lying around eating and drinking, we moved into one of the huts for the night.
You can hear the sound of Andy and John there trying to get out of this canyon. It's a combination of, as we had yesterday, rounded boulders and very, very powdery, soft sand, which are not a good combination on a heavy motorbike. Still, we're nearly out of the canyon, a couple of k's, and then we head north. It should be more, oh, I don't know, it should be easier riding, I hope.
Very powdery sand made it impossible to ride on bikes. So we got out there quick, and even that was a struggle next morning. Got through Ilitsi, and from there we took a new piece for me, the Tarak piece near the Libyan border. It turned out to be a fantastic piece, about 400 kilometres, the long way over the Kajili Nezha Plateau. That was a great ride.
The Tarak route across the Tassili Plateau was a great ride indeed, but soon the desert riders were on the rocks again.
Seem to have lost the other two. About 10 minutes ago, I've been stumbling around here on this very difficult surface, and I just stopped on a high point to see if I could find the piece that we've lost. I notice they're not behind me, so I'm going to go back on the tracks. What I think my tracks are. It's hard to tell on this stuff. And see if I can find them. I think I can hear sound of motorbikes over there. So they could have got round in front of me. Found this track. It's only one track. But I'm pretty sure it's not one of the early ones coming in, because it seems to be curving round that rocky kind of headland, which possibly one of the riders was trying to avoid. And I think I saw Andy going sort of the opposite direction from where he should have been, and then he maybe he was curving round. And yep, this looks good. It could be going, well, we're heading for there, this track is going that way, but as I say, they could be curving around that nasty bit of loose rock, so that's what they may have done, slip round the on the side. Well, I've gotten the bike and I followed their tracks up the sandy wed, but it soon turned into rocks. And I got about half a kilometre further on than where I was before. I was on top of that hill. My bike now is down there in that creek bed. And the terrain here is pretty bad, really as bad as it was when I was on the hill. So I can't believe they would have carried on this stuff. It is very hard to keep together on three bikes when some riders don't like certain terrain, others don't like other sort of terrain. And you can see a better way through. And it's impossible, that's why I'm walking around instead of riding a bike looking for them, because it's impossible to ride and actually look around for anything other than a clear path through these rocks. It's been 2 hours now since I last saw the other two, since we went our separate ways, so to speak, and can't think where they got to. By now, well, who knows, I've given up looking for them, basically. Regarding the getting lost, they misunderstood my instructions and went one way, I went the other. But unfortunately it took them a bit longer than is good, I think, to turn back. But they did that in the end, as I knew they would. And they found me in the wed camped. A little bit of tension. But overall, we were together again. We were just a short distance off the proper track, an easy track, which we've been following now for an hour or so. Unfortunately, Andy's just had a crash. His pannier, his side box, caught the edge of one of these rocks that's along the side of the piste here. It's a very rocky area. And the bike cartwheeled, and he's a bit bashed about. The stuff he knocked out of him, he's not too bad. He's nothing broken. Bike's a bit bent, but it's rideable. So it's a bit of a bleak area here on the plateau top. But found a little wed down there, just a little bit of sand and a tree, slightly softer camping environment, only half a kilometre from where Andy crashed. We'll spend the night there.
Next morning we crowbarred Andy out of his tent, had a brew and carried on down the track, following the edge of the escarpment. We were all low on water as the expected well at Imiru village had been virtually dry, and then as the track turned south it became incredibly rocky, with the inevitable results.
You see Andy's cunningly used the local materials at hand to prop his bike up, namely rocks. We've had a lot of those on this piece today. There's some over there, but we're surrounded by them, let's face it, they're everywhere. But they can be useful for propping a bike up, even if they do cause punctures.
With Andy's puncture fixed, we pressed on south, hoping to get to a waterhole before nightfall.
We're only about 13 k's from the tarmac, and even we can manage that tomorrow in a day. And we've got this nice little rock pool here, or kind of a, not really a rock pool, a sand pool. It was all pretty low on water, so at least we can wash and maybe even boil some of it to make a tea or something. Anyway, just what we needed. This is often the best part of the day, stopping.
But even the last 13 k's of the road were hard won, and we finally rejoined the tarmac near the Tintarajeli Pass for the fantastic ride to Janet. We arrived in town, and as always in these places, first priority was food. We were all pretty dazed by the previous week's efforts on the plateau and looking forward to some R&R, more eating and essential bike maintenance. A day or two later, we were ready for the big run down into the Tenere in Niger, filled up every last container with fuel and water. We had no visas for Niger, but could not face a 1,500-kilometre run to Tamanrasset and back just to get them. Our new plan was to make an illicit excursion via Erkilien to the Lost Tree in the northern Tenere. We'd ride off any recognised tracks to avoid smuggling patrols or the bandits who'd attacked tourists in this region just a few weeks ago. And so we headed back out of Janet and then rode off the highway south towards the Erg Admir dune crossing. Just before the sand got too soft, we stopped to let air out of our tyres to improve traction. But in fact, the fully laden Honda surprised us by getting through in one go, as long as our throttles were kept nailed in third. Once over the dune barrier, we turned directly south, working over mixed terrain until a lunch break.
And if you can see, we've been eating some dates here, from a packet no less, not loose, but still you can find a worm in them. Can you focus on that? Little pink worm, getting a bit of a shock of his life now, getting exposed to the sun. It wouldn't necessarily make it ill, but the idea of eating a little pink worm isn't very appetizing. So generally one eats dates in a messy way, opening it with your teeth, peeling out the stone, and looking inside to see if there's nothing there. This one's clean. Desert chip. Be careful of your dates. Hello, what's it like?
Yeah, hot. It's pretty hot.
It is a hot day today, isn't it? Yeah.
No, it's been lovely day actually. We've had nice open terrain. It's nice to get a break from the.
It's nice to just be able to ride. I still find it quite stressful. Do you?
It is. You feel like you want to relax because it's nice and open. But as soon as you relax, it all starts to go wrong.
Exactly. So, you've got to concentrate all the time, haven't you?
It's paying attention. Yeah.
It's definitely mentally tiring. Physically quite easy today, but mentally as ever.
Yeah.
Very demanding.
I would say so anyway.
Yes. Yeah. Anyway, we can afford to be a bit light-hearted today because. Well, can be though. There's a few hills over there. But anyway, we're within 50 kilometres of our fuel dump, and it's only 3:15. So there's a good chance we're going to make it. I think I said that already, didn't I? Probably beginning to ramble now. It's probably better that we turn off.
After the previous week's relentless rock bashing, the terrain here was wide open and easy, and we made good progress towards the Erkilien fuel dump. We continued over the sand sheet and around minor outcrops, guided by the GPS's arrow and the ever-diminishing distance to the cache. Welcome to Erkilien.
Cut! So we've just arrived at our fuel dump, which is up behind those dunes there. John's fallen over. He's so excited about what he's got in his food stash, he's fallen over. And it's vaguely as I remember it, but there's no footprints, of course, or tyre tracks. So there's been a sandstorm or two through. So, the moment of truth now. Has anyone discovered our stash? Very unlikely. Has it gone off? Has it been attacked by gerbils? Or some sort of other predators out here? Who knows? We've got a barrel of food and we've got 110 litres of fuel up there. So let's go and see if it's still there.
Oh,
Sure enough, all our stuff was still there, buried just below the sand.
We're waiting for one water container. Is that us?
We lugged all the gear back to our camp. Fuel and water were handy, of course, but what we really wanted to get our hands on were the goodies stashed in the food barrel. Feeling like Father Christmas, I dished out all the treats. Nothing had gone off or burst in 2 months, and even before the barrel was empty, we were tucking in.
Super noodles, gotta be John. Bachelor noodles. Statue! Ah! Oh, Frankfurters, more Frankfurters.
So, yes, the mood is good. We've got a pile of fantastic food, heaps of fuel, plenty of water, drink. Weather's nice, it's warm, 29 degrees here at 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock. Might even sleep out with that tent tonight for the first time since we got here. And yes, better start cooking.
Having stuffed our faces and slept like logs, we got up at dawn to prepare for the 2-day run across no man's land into Niger and the tree.
We're going to, on Erkilian, we're going to have to go west until we get past the Erg. From that point, just put the GPS point for the tree into our GPSs and head straight for it, southeast, bearing of around 140, and ride until we get there, really.
So we're just getting ready to set off now to the tree. John's lashing his 25 litre fuel drum on the back, and he's already got his lashed on. We're calculating we've got enough fuel to get there and back. Kind of obvious, really, isn't it? We're a little bit nervous now, obviously. This is a big stage. This is the sharp end of the trip, really. But we've calculated everything as well as we can. We've got fuel and water. We've got reserved fuel and water here. So there's a good chance that we'll make it. We'll find out. If you watch this, we did.
We set off directly east to get round the Erg and then turned southeast towards a GPS point we guessed was on the Algerian-Niger border. Although not everyone seemed to agree which way was southeast. Once we got to the border, there were no signs of course, we topped up the bike's main tanks from the fuel drums to lessen the load. We then decided to construct a monument or balise from the empty fuel drums to commemorate the historic passage of the Desert Riders project.
Gathered here today, second of February, to inaugurate the Desert Riders Balise here on the Algerian-Niger border. We built this balise in the spirit of spare fuel drums, basically. I'm now going to light the Desert Riders Balise, so it will shine as a beacon to all who come this way, mostly smugglers and the odd crackpot English Desert Riders project. Burning.
I'm going to do okay. So for the next 20 seconds.
Let us now sing the Desert Rider song.
That's how it goes.
Okay. Desert Riders, Desert Riders, sing the song, come on.
There we go.
Desert Riders, Desert Riders, riding the desert. So it will burn for 1,000 years and a day.
Or until the petrol.
Or until the petrol runs out. Thank you.
With a new monument to add to all future maps, we keyed in the GPS coordinates of the tree and set off into Niger in the unknown. As expected, the sands of the northern Tenere were pancake flat with just the occasional soft patch, and by dusk we were within 100 kilometres of the tree. To be on the safe side, we camped using no lights, and were on the move again by dawn.
A cold morning here in the Tenere, which is about 100 kilometres away by 9 o'clock. We finally reached the southernmost point of our trip. It might as well be the South Pole, so cold here this morning. And currently we're illegal immigrants to the Republic of Niger, and we crossed the border yesterday midday. And during that 3 o'clock visit into Niger without a visa, we decided not to bother with visas.
Desert riders here at the Arbre Thierry Sabine, formerly known as the Arbre Perdu or Lost Tree, because it is a tree lost here in the vast expanse of the Tenere Desert. It was renamed by the French, maybe not officially, but by them, as the Arbre Thierry Sabine when the founder of the Dakar Rally died during the Dakar Rally in 1986. He actually died in Mali, near Timbuktu, but because he had a near-death experience on one of the early rallies here as a racer on a motorbike in the late 70s, the Tenere was a special place for Thierry Sabine and the Dakar Rally in the 80s, so he had his ashes scattered here a few days after his death in, yeah, I'd say 1986. And then they got a bit of marble from the Blue Mountains, which are on the other side of the Tenere, near the Ayer Mountains. They got some of this blue marble that carved his name or some sort of inscription on it. Some others have added their own graffiti to it, but that marble there is brought in as a kind of tombstone, or whatever you want to call it, to Thierry Sabine, a desert rider much like ourselves.
We've got a long ride back now to our base camp, which we left yesterday, about 400 km away. We've got a nice pot of fruit there, so that will kind of egg us on to get there, hopefully tonight before sunset.
Sure enough, we made it back before sunset, having covered a record 450 kilometres in one day, and even had the energy for a bit of dune surfing on John's sandboard. The Tenere had been a fantastic ride, but now it was time for the long ride back north and then west towards the Holgar. But then, more problems.
His third puncture in about 50 kilometres, and he's decided very, very courteously to leave the group and head home, because really he's using all our inner tubes as well as his ones to make repairs. But now Andy faces what I faced myself over the years, the long ride home with your trip falling apart around your ears. And Andy.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye from Andy. That leaves only John Escombe.
To say hello.
And me. We'll probably head for the Hoggar Mountains, assuming we don't have problems of our own. And from there we'll obviously raid Andy's food stash in Tamanrasset, and we'll see what happens from there. That's what happens out here. When things go wrong, you've got to, I think, in my experience, know when to call it a day. You've got to know when to turn back. You can't keep hoping, carrying on, thinking things will work out. Out here in Algeria, there's no chance of getting a second tyre, or very little chance, or an inner tube. And these things are a problem for all desert travellers with vehicles. So he's doing what I would have done myself, which is turn back before we've got no energy left at all. So Andy goes home, John and I carry on. John and I had a bet last night that I couldn't push start my bike down this sandy, deeply, softly, sandily wet here.
It's pretty hard in daylight.
It's very, very deep, soft sand. He reckons I can't push my bike.
Hardest sand in the Sahara.
And we've bet each other a full tank of fuel, which is 800 dinars worth.
I thought it was a chip omelette, but I'm confident.
Yep, okay, so... softly churned, sandy wed. A quarter of a ton of Honda XRL. And a tank of fuel rests on the outcome.
One thing to note, Chris thinks he's got away with not packing his bike fully before he pushes it. But he hasn't, I've spotted that one, so we'll take a brief interlude till he gets it fully loaded.
No, it's pretty little. That's only, 20 kilos maximum. Anyway, I hand the camera to you, Mr. Escombe.
Righto.
Okay. Watch this. Okay. I think you're hovering over a starter button. Back on compression. Free the clutch plates. Okay. Oh, full choke.
I thought I was down a tank of fuel there, but he's faltering. He could barely hold it up right now. It soon takes it out of you, this off sand. Fill her up, Mr. Scott!
I tell you, a tank of fuel, John. Couldn't quite get there. Look at that. That's worth riding 700k's for, isn't it? Chicken, chips and salad. John and I have just arrived at Tamanrasset. Finished our lunch. We've not had any breakfast because we were out of water and food. And we're going to head for the campsite in the south of town. Change the oil on the bikes. Have a rest day. And in a couple of days head north for our final challenge via the Hoggar Mountains. So, from Tamanrasset, au revoir from Desert Riders.
At the campsite, John and I plan the final stage of our route. Up and over the Hoggar Mountains to Garrett El Janoun and onto the Amgid crater and our final fuel stash.
It means winding along various canyons. And we know what canyons are like now, don't we?
Soft sand and large round boulders.
Yes.
Not a good mix.
Not a good mix with a motorbike full of fuel. So we'll see how that goes. It's only 60k's, but of course that could take 2 weeks.
But next morning some other bikers turned up, including a guy I'd met from the year before. Plus it was the festival of Abraham or Tabaski. A holiday for everyone unless you're a goat. In the end though, there was no holding back the remnants of the Desert Riders project, and John and I set off on the classic ride up to Asagram. Climbed ever higher into the volcanic massif, rattling over the rocks, with our back-heavy bikes handling up barges through the steep hairpins. Sakrum, we stopped off and did the sunset sunrise thing. One of the highlights of any Sahara trip. And then it was down the far rockier western descent, 150 metres or more, which really took it out of us. Our panniers and some guns bashing against the rocks.
Back on the piece today after three days off in Tamarasset, and went back to that exhausted, backache, worn out feeling, just good for nothing. After all we did was today was 80k's up to the Asakrem and about 60k's down. We're quite near Tamarasset now, but we're camping here tonight because there's no point in going to town, we get there in the dark.
We got back on the Trans-Saharan Highway and rode up to Inamgel village. Here we made sure we filled it with plenty of water as there was only one well in the next 1,000 k's. And then we got back on the piste and headed towards Garad El Junoun mountain.
I appear to have had a crash. Don't ask me what happened. I think I was behind. And we're heading for Garad El Junoun. I'm a bit knocked out. Possibly a broken rib or two, but I'll be okay. Arms and legs are good. I don't know what happened. Oh, John reckons a pannier dug in or something. We're on the piste. We're heading for Garad El Junoun to climb it, which is going to be fun. Don't ask me what happened. I haven't got a clue. I guess I was knocked out. Well, here I am, with my helmet as a pillow. I don't know how I got here.
And our pannier was about here. White was over there, being moved out of the way now. Chris still lying pretty much where he fell.
I'm still trying to piece it together, but it's not quite there yet. Best news is that arms and legs are good, possibly a broken rib. I may be repeating myself, you have to excuse me if I am. Couple of aspirins maybe. And the bike's rideable. So... okay. Cut, I think.
We're on the empty piece. Unfortunately last night I had a bit of a crash. Some cross channels coming off a hill. Got out of shape. Something dug in. And I flipped over. And now I can't ride a bike. That's the end of desert riders, I guess. Boy, that's a lot. We're a bit frustrated because we had a few good things to do here. We were looking forward to climbing Garad El Junoun Mountain, just behind me now, Mountain of Ghosts. Thank you for visiting desertriders.co.uk. See you, I'm from John. Welcome, John, that was. Bye.